doesn't even advocate merely enslaving the leftovers. The Bible advocates in Deuteronomy 20:10 that you should go and make, proclaim peace to a tribe or a city that you fight with. And if they agree to peace, then you enslave them. That's verses 10 and 12 of Deuteronomy 20. How is that?
You have a basic presupposition that I disagree with. And that basic presupposition that you keep on banging on is because the Bible says it, that makes it true. And good and moral. I started out with Matthew 19, guys. And in Matthew 19, Jesus is not saying that divorce is good.
Can you connect slavery to Matthew 19?
Absolutely. It's a basic principle of interpretation which says, just because there are laws in the Pentateuch that communicate if you're going to divorce, then you need to give your wife a certificate of divorce. It doesn't make that God's ideal.
I didn't know there was anything about ideal. We're talking about permissive.
Matt, we just interrupted who here, Matt?
That's fair, but you're repeating the same thing that we've already addressed.
We just interrupted who, Matt?
I interrupted you. I fully acknowledge that.
All right. Okay. Go ahead, Matt. You're at the floor. Wait. Let me just try and think about it.
I'm saying this, I think, is immoral. What difference does it make whether or not it was God's ideal?
So you're talking about the suzerain and vassal treaties, right? And so if you think about, for example, Joshua in Joshua chapter 10, where Israel is supposed to, as the suzerain, help out the vassal Gibeonites, and they end up doing that in a very peaceful, and we know we actually even use the word love, going back to this vassal suzerain terminology, starts in Genesis with God and man, and then even in regards to Pharaoh, it's used. But then there's another place in Scripture outside of Joshua where the suzerain, being the Israelites, don't go and save the Gibeonites, and God punishes them for it. And so there's clearly a connection there where God is calling for that loving relationship where you are helping out those who are less than you.
Okay, so two things. One, Deuteronomy 20 is very clearly distinguishing, right, those that are afar and those that are in the land of Israel. Right, so those that are afar become corvée labor if they submit. Best case scenario for them, right? They become mas, in which the Hebrew term for like tribute, corvée labor, right? So what Solomon does with Israelites and what Solomon does with foreigners, this is something that you're forced to work, right? I don't think I wouldn't consider them slaves proper according to the definition that we gave earlier, but they're corvée labor, right? So what you see with the Gibeonites also is not like the Gibeonites, that was in the narrative, the best case scenario for that. They either are standard harem, right, under the ban and are annihilated, or they trick the Israelites and become like these water carriers, right? So they're corvée labor. I think we need to be real honest about what the narrative is saying. This isn't like, we wouldn't do this today. We wouldn't do it.
This is going to be the big part of the debate. This is where I agree with you. We're not going to be operating in the same way.
Gotcha, bitch.